appreciate our brother Sam Grant for granting us this space to be able to share the word again. I've been here about 2 or 3 times now, and I realized that he had been to Nigeria and had come to Makurdi, you know, at a point, isn't it? We thank God. And Sid and Jean, thank you very much. Paul, so much ahead. And Mama Joyce, we thank God. This evening, I will have us to spend a bit of time looking at Jesus' personal introduction of himself. There are several things that people have said about Jesus. There are several things that others have proposed or propounded about who Jesus is. But Jesus himself was not dumb about himself. And he was deliberate in bringing a progressive introduction about himself to those who will follow him. And when he was about going, the final prayers he prayed for his disciples, there was something critical there. He says, "This is eternal life, that they may know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent." And the word of God says, "They that do know their God, they shall be strong, and they will do exploits." Whereas it would look ordinary, and ordinarily to be presumed that people that are already in the church, they know the Christ of the church, which again and again, as I traveled about, I found that it's a very costly assumption. Many people are quite eager and zealous, but our knowledge of whom we serve is quite weak and deficient. And it manifests very quickly in the way we have responded to challenges that has come our way. And looking at our present situation and predicaments, as many more have turned away from the church, and as you move on the street, what used to be a common story, a common knowledge, is gradually becoming very strange. When you tap on somebody on the road and say, "Do you know Jesus?" Even in this country, it's appalling that young people from 30 years and below, they are quite vague about who Jesus is. They are quite vague about what is his purpose, and what is his mission, and what does Jesus Christ mean unto us. So this night, I felt the Lord will have me spend a bit of time for us to look together again at Jesus, and what does he say about himself, and how does that impact on our lives as individuals and on our faith as those who have come to believe? And how does that affect our experience? Because if Jesus is real, he is to be experienced. The difference between those who will bring a lot of philosophies and what we represent is that our faith is not a philosophy. Our faith is not a cognitive matter. is a relationship, is an experience. And what we have been called to know is not things, is not subjects, is not topics. We have been called to know him. And Paul said that I may know him and the power of his resurrection. So this night, we'll go through a bit of scriptures, trying to trace what is Jesus' personal introduction of himself to us, and how do we draw from that what he says about himself as we place our faith afresh in the risen Lord. Let's pray together. Our Father, this night we ask that you will reveal yourself to us. You took your disciples aside. You went to Caesarea Philippi, and you deliberately wanted to reveal yourself to them. You said, "Whom do men say that I, the Son of Man, am?" You took three of them to the Mount of Transfiguration just to unveil yourself to them, because you know that eternal life is only going to be real when we get to know you. So tonight, Lord, we ask that you will again take the veil from off our eyes, that we might see Jesus. We ask, Lord, that you will appear afresh into our spirits. And as we see you, we'll be able to shout like men of old, "I have seen the Lord." Lord, we ask that whatever needs that we have come into this fellowship with, whatever challenges we had faced, we ask that as we meet the risen Lord, as we encounter you afresh, as we get to know who you say you are, we ask that, Lord, your very life will impact upon us, and that there will be a measure of revival, a measure of restoration, a measure of recommitment unto the person of our Lord Jesus. Thank you for hearing us. Please grant us help tonight and grant us liberty as we look at the truth of your word. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Thank you very much. There are several scriptures that I would like to draw your attention to tonight as we begin to look at Jesus. But I would like to read John chapter 20 as our basic scripture where we could kick off from. John chapter 20, verse 30 and verse 31. John 20, 30 and 31. This was almost like the concluding remark of the entire gospel of the book of John. And I found that the book of John, the gospel of John, was so precious because it appears to me as if whereas several other gospelers, Matthew, Luke, Mark, whereas they were concerned majorly about what Jesus did, his compassionate ministry, or what Jesus taught about the principles of the kingdom. But as I look at the book of John, the Gospel of John, I found something peculiar. I found that John was particularly intense about knowing who this man is. Who is this son? So you will notice that right from the very beginning unto this last comment that he was about making, John had focused almost without distraction on the person of the Lord Jesus. Now, at the end of that book, he now said, and many other signs. That's verse 30. Truly, did Jesus in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written that ye might believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that believing ye might have life through his name. That was like the concluding point of this book, even though chapter 21 came as if something strange took place and Jesus Christ had to come back. So he had to add that chapter afresh, and by the time he's concluding again, he was still again concluding that there are also many other things which Jesus did, the which if they should be written everyone, I suppose that even the world itself could not contain the books that should be written. Now, so taking our reference and our bearing from this tonight, I'd like to note that as we look at our Lord Jesus, he is inexhaustible, he is undescribable. If we were to write and write and write about Jesus, the whole books of this world may be written and it will not have exhausted the man of Calvary. But what is it that God has done? He has given us privilege of that which has been written and that which he himself said about himself for a purpose. And the purpose is that these things that has been written were written that you might believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that believing you might have life through his name. Again, I found it very refreshing to discover that all that were written about Jesus was not meant for entertainment, was not just meant for cognitive exercise, that is, mental exercise. Say, oh, I know this, I know this, I know this. No, there's a purpose. They were written that as we get to know them, we will believe. And in believing, we will have life through his name. So this night, so much, but I just intend that I'll take two or three that Jesus Christ has spoken about himself that we could reflect upon, we could meditate together about, and draw what will be the implication of the personality of our Lord Jesus Christ upon our lives individually and upon our profession of faith, especially as we are crying for revival, as we are crying for restoration, as we are crying for a fresh visitation. And my understanding is that there will be no revival, there will be no fresh visitation unless we have a fresh revelation of Jesus. It's not about more activities that will bring revival to us. It will be fresh encounter with him, fresh revelation with him. Isaiah had preached for years, but when he saw the Lord, something new started with his life. Paul was very injurious and reckless, but when he encountered the risen Lord, his life changed, his ministry changed, and his influence had continued up to this point in which even we ourselves are. So one way, I'm very, very deeply, deeply convinced in my heart that if we're going to see an enduring visitation of God even now, we must preach Jesus. Not just to preach Jesus by inference. Not just to sprinkle Jesus' name upon so many, many, many concepts. Not just to refer to Jesus as a good man that we may emulate. That is not going to give us any measure of the move of God. Jesus and Him crucified, we must encounter afresh. And you might wonder, but we already know Jesus. Why does this brother bother us about this? Permit me to say to you that, yes, I do not disregard the fact that you know. But I believe that if you are going to keep fresh, if you are going to remain vibrant, if your faith is going to be sprouting, knowing Jesus must not be an historical knowledge. It must be current. It must be fresh. It must be engaging. We must be touching Him regularly, daily, and that's what will keep us fresh in our faith, in our walk with God. So I want to draw a few issues that He spoke about. There are many, but time will not allow us to be doing all of that. I just highlight about three or four issues that He said about Himself that I will want you to think and pray about tonight. Let's take it from the book of John, and I'll start from John chapter 6. I want us to read John chapter 6. And in John chapter 6, I would like to read from verse 26, 27, 32, 33, up to 35. And I will quickly ask you to look at 48 up to 51. And if I'm able to stop at verse 55 up to 57, that would be okay. Now 26, Jesus answered them and said, "Verily, verily, I say unto you, you seek me, not because you saw the miracles, but because you did eat of the loaves and were filled. Labor not for the meat which perishes, but for that meat which endures unto everlasting life, which the Son of Man shall give unto you, for him has God the Father sealed." Then they said unto him in verse 28, "What shall we do that we might work the works of God?" And Jesus answered and said to them, "This is the work of God, that you believe on him whom he has sent." Will you please move with me now to verse 32 and 33 up to 35. Then Jesus said to them, "Verily, verily, I say unto you, Moses gave you not that bread from heaven, but my Father gives you the true bread from heaven. For the bread of God is he which cometh down from heaven and giveth life unto the world." Then said they unto him, "Lord, evermore give us this bread." And Jesus said to them, "I am the bread of life. He that comes to me shall never hunger, and he that believes on me shall never thirst. Please go with me to 47. "Verily, verily, I say unto you, he that believes on me has everlasting life. I am that bread of life. Your fathers did eat manna in the wilderness and are dead. This is the bread which comes down from heaven, that a man may eat thereof and not die. I am the living bread which came down from heaven. If any man eat of this bread, he shall live forever. And the bread that I will give is my flesh, which I will give for the life of the world. Let me stop there, because I will end in verse 57 later. Now, this is a very wonderful discussion. And why did I want us to look at it? It is because I continuously discover that one of the things that has brought the church to where we have reached and that has reduced the impact of the church presently in our generation was when our emphasis shifted from the person of Jesus onto the benefits that we derive from him. Please take note. Now, there were these people that Jesus had fed them. You remember he fed 5,000 people? Do you remember? And the following day, many of them came and they were eager. They wanted to see Jesus. In fact, the Bible said they took shipping. They took shipping. And as they came, they said, "Rabbi, when did you come here? We have been looking for you." And Jesus Christ, instead of being overwhelmed and excited about the crowd that has now come, these many thousands of people that are now coming, and he will have given them another bread, isn't it? And they will have eaten and they will have just keep coming. But he did not see a future in that. He said, "You seek me, not because you saw the miracles, but because you did eat of the loaves and you were filled. Labor not for the meat which perishes, for that meat which endureth unto everlasting life is what you needed to labor for, which the Son of Man shall give unto you, for him as God the Father put a seal upon." Now, is Jesus Christ opposed to giving them more bread? He had given them bread before. But you see, naturally, by human nature, we will normally only choose that which is visible, that which will soon finish and fade. And sometimes, even as preachers, we are tempted all the time not to give Jesus unto men, but to give them something that temporarily settles their problem if they can keep coming. But now, we have come to a generation where some of those things that we would have loved to use to attract people, say, if you come, he will give you money, he will do this, he will do that. When technology came, and all of those things seem to be available even without prayer, when it looks as if the things that we will have looked and cried to God about, you could actually get it without praying. One of the questions that started rising in the minds of many is, so why do I need him? Because they have always thought they needed him as a means of getting some things. They've never seen Jesus as the one to look for. And it's possible that you could spend years in the church seeking something to which you thought God is a means of getting. I don't know whether you follow me to that point. It's possible that somebody is here. I am in this church because I am told that if I come here, I will get a man to marry. Now, when the man sits there, when the lady has sat here for 2, 3 years, 4 years, 5 years, and no man is coming on her path, she says, so, I'm disappointed. There's nothing in the church. What do they have for me there? Nothing. Let me go somewhere else. Because unconsciously and unfortunately, we presented Jesus not for Jesus' sake. We presented Jesus as a means of getting something else. And I see that all the time. I see that all the time. Each time you listen to preachers, they are so overwhelmed about advertising something else for which Jesus is a stepping stone unto. But people that endured in their faith, Jesus was the end, not a means to an end. Jesus was the answer. He was the sum of all things that we will ever get in life. So these people came. Oh, why? We have been looking for you. We have been looking for you. They were zealous. But they were not zealous about Jesus. They were zealous about what they would get Jesus to do. And even though church may look nice when they are gathering around things that they think Jesus is a means of getting, let's face the fact, such kind of profession cannot have an enduring experience. It will still scatter. Now we have come to a point where we are saying, Lord, we need revival. Lord, we need revival. How do we get the kind of revival we are looking for? We've got to again return. We've got to return unto what is the crux of the gospel. What is it that our fathers saw? That even when there was no money, when there was nothing, when they were sick, they couldn't let go. It's because they saw Jesus. They saw that Jesus is not just a means of getting something. They saw that Jesus himself is what to get. Jesus himself is the object to pursue. Jesus himself is the treasure that they must collect. And so I saw Jesus Christ deliberately, and I want, because I need to move quickly with time tonight and establish what I need to establish so that we can pray together. I saw Jesus saying to them, look, why do you labor for the meat that perishes? It's not that God will not give you healing. And if you are here tonight and your need is a divine touch on your health, that's not a problem with God. But the truth is that all those who have been healed before, they will still die. Isn't it? Even healing is one of the meat that perishes. Why do you put the cart before the horse? So Jesus said, why do you labor for meat that perishes and not for the meat that endures. Why don't you look for that which the Father has put seal upon? Now, the people quickly turned around again, you know, and these are all quiet deception. Can I point this to you again? Immediately they changed. They said, okay, what shall we do to walk the works of God? Even that, you know, that looks very lucrative. Somebody wants to walk the works of God. In their question, there's already a small blasphemy. Who can walk the work of God for God? Is there anybody who can walk the work of God? No. God is the only one who can do his work by himself. Am I right? So they say, what can we do that we may walk the works of God? And Jesus reduced all that they are talking about. He said, this is the work of God, that you believe on him whom he has sent. I can imagine that many of us, we want to do something for God, but Jesus is saying, no. All that you will want to call the work of God is summarized in one matter. What is it? Just believe on him, this man Jesus, whom God has sent. When we begin to understand what is it that is the essence of our faith, God is not introducing a philosophy to us. God is not introducing a set of church dogmas to us. God is saying, this is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. Hear him. When the church leaves the person of Jesus and put him in the cooler and begin to run with activities, with rules and regulations, we will miss it. We may be zealous, we may be hardworking, but it is not enduring. Because Christianity is not about activities, it's about Christ in you. Paul said, the mystery is this. And what is the mystery? Christ in you, the hope of glory. Praise God. Brother Paul said to the Galatians, he said, whether you are Jew or Greek, circumcision or no circumcision is not the issue. Whether somebody has Christ is what matters. How I pray that our understanding will come into a very clear head. That what matters, what God has been standing to present to us, what we come to church, what we go for meetings to accomplish is only one thing, Christ in you and the hope of glory. If it is not Christ formed in us, then we have no life. So Jesus said, look, he said, the people were asking, so, okay, what sign will you give us so that we may believe you? Moses gave us a manna in the wilderness. You know, we ate bread from heaven. And Jesus said, may I tell you, Moses did not give you that manna, that bread from heaven, but my Father giveth you the true bread from heaven. For the bread of God, please take note now, is he which cometh down from heaven and gives life unto the world. I don't know whether our world will understand that there is no life in this world until the bread of God that came from heaven has entered into them. Men may be educated, they may be highly intellectual, they may be very eloquent, they may have money, But may I say very, very solemnly that they have no life. Say, he who has the Son has life. And he who does not have the Son has no life. The wrath of God abides in him. Brothers and sisters, the first thing to be checking is, do you have him? You may have degrees, you may have certificates, you may have what you call connections, you may have money, you may have lands. But essentially, when we go down to the reality, honestly speaking, you are a poor man. He that does not have the Son has no life. No life. The bread that came down from heaven, that God gives, that gives life unto the world, is this man, Jesus. And maybe you are very, very zealous, you are ambitious, you are seeking something to happen in your life. Can I say that what will bring you to the manifestation of your expectation is this man, Jesus? If he's not there, there's no life. And I saw Jesus deliberately now saying, I am the bread of life. He that comes to me shall never hunger, and he that believes on me shall never thirst. I am the bread of life. Only the Holy Spirit will open your eyes to understand that actually, the bread of life that will quench your hunger, that will quench your thirst, that will settle you for life, is Jesus. It's Jesus. It is not some theoretical analysis. It is the person of Jesus. It is that direct encounter with him to say, Jesus, I want to eat this bread. But can I say something that looks funny to me? But it's my simple understanding. Now, if Sam, you are hungry, and your wife brought bread and put it on the table, does the bread on the table quench your hunger?
For a little while.
Eh?
For a little while.
I'm asking first. That you are hungry, and your wife sets the bread on the table, and you are looking at the bread. Does that quench your hunger? When does it quench your hunger? When you eat it. Did it quench your hunger when you smell it? Does it quench your hunger when you took it around and said, "Ah, this brand bread, oh yeah, this good bread." Does it quench your hunger? When does it quench your hunger? When you eat it. When you eat it. When you swallow it. When you transfer it from what it is on the table and you take it inside. May I say that Jesus that you admire on the outside does not quench your thirst. Jesus that you wave to on the outside does not help you. That Jesus must enter into you. So he began to tell them, say, only those who eat me and drink me has life in themselves. By the time he was going to conclude, he became quite serious because many of the people didn't understand, and some of them were murmuring and saying, what does this man mean? What does this man mean? But instead of him to have reduced what he was saying, He rather intensified it. He said, look at what he said in verse 48. I am that bread of life. Your fathers did eat manna in the wilderness and they are dead. Manna was miracle, isn't it? Manna was wonderful. But manna couldn't stop them from perishing in the wilderness. Even though it came from heaven, it was falling for them every day. He said, this is the bread which comes down from heaven that a man may eat thereof and not die. I am the living bread which came down from heaven. If any man eat of this bread, he shall live forever. And the bread that I will give is my flesh, which I will give for the life of the world. Now, inside that little Bible verse, I saw Jesus beginning to lay a foundation. How will this bread, this living bread, how will it be transferred into this man? How will this living bread, which is the life of Jesus, how will it be transferred here? Whereas if it was ordinary physical bread, how do you transfer physical bread into your stomach so that you can quench your hunger? How do you do it? You put it in your mouth, you eat it, you chew it. You chew it. But how are we going to have the life of Jesus transfer from external into our own lives? Now, he was pointing at something there. He said, and I want to read that verse again, I am the living bread which came down from heaven. If any man eat of this bread, he shall live forever. And the bread that I will give is my flesh, which I give for the life of the world. And I say, when did he give his flesh for the life of the world? When he went to Calvary. When he was crucified. May I say to you that the death of Jesus at Calvary was to accomplish two things. It was to evacuate from us the old life that will not allow us to be victorious, and to replace inside of us the very life of Jesus. So when he gave his life for us on the cross, he was doing so that we also may have, as by exchange, his own very life inside of us. So we hear the word of God saying, knowing this, that our old man was crucified with him, so that we might no longer live under the power of sin and have for Christ to live in us. So Brother Paul now said, I'm crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live. But it's not my life, but Christ that does what? That lives in me. He said, for if righteousness, now I want you to note this, if righteousness were to come by rules and regulations, if there's a way by which you can work so hard and you will be able to live well, Christ does not need to die. So if righteousness were to come by the works of the law, then Christ died in vain. The only way by which the living bread can be transferred from outside of us into the inside of us is by his death, that whosoever will believe, they will come into that experience where the living bread is no more outside. But where is it now? It's inside of them. And because the bread of life now is in me, I have life to live. Brothers and sisters, let me ask. This may look like, is it not the old simple gospel story that we have been told? But I tell you, no matter how many years the gospel story had been told, is ever fresh, is ever new, is ever effective. And even tonight, all those who will have life, that's the only way to have it. I am the bread of life. Verily, verily, I say to you, this is verse 53, and I'm going to read it up to verse 57, and then I think I'll move away from there. Verily, verily, I say to you, except you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in you. When he used the word except, the new English now, they will not use the word except, they will use the word unless. And unless simply means there is no other way by which you will have life in you except by this way. Now, the world system, the modern day people, they don't want us to tell them this. They feel that no. You cannot, there are many other ways by which people can live. Let's note, regardless of the intimidation that is going on, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and you drink his blood, you have no life in you. Whoso eateth my flesh and drinks my blood has eternal life, and I will raise him up at the last day. For my flesh is meat indeed, and my blood is drink indeed. He that eats my flesh and drinks my blood dwells in me, and I in him. Now, Jesus was introducing a very critical issue that would turn the lives of men about. They were going up and down looking for bread. But he was saying, look, why do you labor for what perishes? Why do you look for that which cannot endure? Why don't you take that inside of you will be there forever? Now, you know, as I'm looking at this, I found Jesus very, very, very passionate about each person he has ever encountered. You will remember that this kind of discussion, even though here he's talking about the bread, but in chapter 4, when he encountered the woman of Samaria, the woman that came to fetch water by the well, and he was asking the woman, give me to drink. And the woman said, what do you have? And he just said, if you have known the gift of God, and you have known he who is telling you to give him water, you will have asked me to give you my own water. Because whosoever drink this water you are coming to fetch, he will thirst again. But whosoever will drink the water that I will give him, he will never thirst again, because the water that I will give him will become in him a well. Now, I keep discovering that, yes, our generation is looking for temporary things, things that they can quickly use and it will finish. But God offers us that which endures, that which never finishes, that which will keep springing. Now, as Jesus Christ came to the end of this, the result was that many people did not understand what he said, or maybe they understood, but they thought it was too hard, and they left. And Jesus turned to the 12 and said, will you also go? I was excited that Peter stood up and said, to who shall we go? We know, and we believe that you are the Son of the living God, and you are the one that has the words of eternal life. May I ask, do you know that Jesus is not just a means to getting something, but that he himself is the bread of life? He is the one that is the life. He is the one, it is his body, it is his life that God gave so that the world may have life. That all those who will ever have life in this life, they must be those who, by faith, has come for that man Jesus, no longer to be outside of them, to be transferred to live in them. And this is only possible because he went to Calvary. It was his death that makes it possible for his life to be born in us. Don't think I'm being rude. I would just be asking a question. Has that happened? Do you have life in yourself? Is it bubbling? Are you freshly? I'm not talking of something that happened 20, 30 years and it has dried. In your spirit today, is he alive? Are you able to say with men of old, he is alive in me? I may not have anything else in the world, but I have all that I need to have, which is Jesus. Hallelujah. Now, what else did he say about himself that I thought we could look at tonight before we pray together? What did he say again about himself? In chapter 8, verse 12, Jesus spoke up again and said, I am the light of the world. Isn't it? He that follows me shall not walk in darkness, but shall have the light of life. I am the light of the world. You know, sometimes I'm studying Jesus. I'm looking at him. I say, Lord, you are so confident. Why do you say that kind of thing of yourself? And he says, because that's the truth. There's nothing else. I am the light of the world. Jesus is the light of the world. May I say to you, without Jesus, any man in the world is in darkness. Is in darkness. And sometimes the church, we may have lost confidence in who Jesus himself is, to the point that we are becoming intimidated. We could not stand up and shout and say, look here, you have no light until you meet Jesus. I am the light of the world. All those who follow me, they will not walk in darkness. What he simply says there is that all those who do not follow me, they walk in darkness. They are in darkness. I don't need to go on and on searching the scriptures because that is everywhere. I am the light. Now, what does that mean for me? I'm hearing Jesus saying, look, the light you need in this world is me. The light that will keep you walking, never to stumble, is Jesus. All those who shall believe in me, that follows me, they will not walk in darkness, but they shall have the light of life. I am the light of the world. What's the first thing we dealt with this night? I am the bread of life, isn't it? I am the light of the world. Those who follow me. And brothers and sisters, some of us are still young, and the entire world seems to be flashing all kinds of lights. But may I say to you that even when the world seems to be flashing light, it's darkness. It's darkness. Until you find your bearing in Christ, you will be confused. Until Christ becomes the light of your life, you will walk in darkness and you will stumble. So in chapter 9, it says, as long as I'm in this world, I am the light of the world. But you know, at the end, all those that have received Jesus into their lives, what did he say about us also? He said, and you also, you are the light of the world. When do I become the light of the world? When the light of the world dwells in me. Isn't it? I only have light to shine on my generation when right inside of me, the light of the world, which is Jesus, has found a place or abode in my life, in my spirit. Then I have something to show men. I have something to share with the people. I have something to point my generation to. And may I deeply say that if we are going to experience the move of God afresh, even though many people are expecting many things, they think something will, a wind will blow, a roof will remove. My understanding is that revival is only but a fresh encounter with the man of color. When it comes afresh to your life, you will not walk in darkness. Every aspect of darkness in any man's life that has encountered Christ will disappear. And you will see him coming out again afresh. In chapter 10, he said, I am the door of the sheep. Have you come across that? I am the door of the sheep. That one overwhelmed my heart. Hearing Jesus say, look, I am the door. You cannot enter. You cannot enter unless you come by me. You cannot enter into all that God has kept in store for you unless you come by the door. I am the door of the sheep. Since tonight is not for us to be reasoning with pastors and preachers, tonight is just for us to examine our Lord Jesus. I am the door of the sheep. I don't know how to put that, brothers and sisters. Jesus is the door. Imagine that you want to enter this building and the door is locked. And you went round, you couldn't get at the door. What can you do? Can't do anything. You will only be out there. There is comfort here, but you have no way to enter because you couldn't get at the door. Brothers, I am the door. Jesus said, I'm the door of the sheep. I'm the door. I'm the door. There is no other entry into life except by me. There's no other way you will enter to where God wants you to be. It's by me. I am the door. I'm the door. I'm the door of the sheep. I'm the door. I'm the door. Brother, he is the door. Stop running up and down. He is the door. Stop knocking here and there. He is the door. I'm the door of the sheep. But you see, it was exciting that the man Jesus, who said, I'm the door, also say, I am the shepherd. Can you imagine that? I am the entry point. I'm yet the sustainer. If to say Jesus is just the door that you enter through and you lock him and then you are just roaming about, it's different. But he said, I am the door. You come by me. You come by me. You enter in. I'm the one who opens for you. But I'm also the shepherd who takes you to the pasture, who leads you to where you need to be, who provides all that you need. I am the shepherd, not just ordinary shepherd. I'm not a hireling. I am the good shepherd who lays down my life. This night, brothers and sisters, it might look as if I'm stating the obvious, but let me restate it again. He is the door. It's the door. There is no other entry point for our nation. It is still Jesus. Don't think that people have discovered something that will help them. Nothing. Nothing will help them. Don't think all the young people, they are running here, they are saying this, they are talking this, as if they have discovered another entry point. They are outside. And there is no hope for our people until they come to this door. I'm the door. And this door is ageless. Do you get me? It was not the door in the 18th century, and in the 21st century, the door has changed. No, it's still the door. Do you know that Northern Ireland? We shut out the door. And we are looking for identity somewhere else. And he looks and says, no, let's forget church. Let's forget all of that. Let's do something else. What can you do when you are not yet entering by the doorway? I am the door of the sheep. And I'm the good shepherd. I'm the good shepherd. And what is the good shepherd? The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. Has he laid down his life for us? As he made himself a ransom for our deliverance, I am the door. Finally, he said, I am the resurrection and the life. Time will fail me to look at what he meant. Martha was saying, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. Oh, Jesus said, yes. What you don't know is that actually, I am. Not that I will resurrect your brother. Even myself, I am the resurrection. I am the life. No, he has died for 4 days. He's already smelling. He said, that's not the question. You are worried about all of that because you don't know me. Actually, I am the life. I am the resurrection. Even though he's dead and he's thinking, that's not the issue. I'm the resurrection. I am the life. He who believes in me, even if he dies, he will live. And if he has not died, he will not die again. Ah, the resurrection and the life is here. And maybe, yes, he says something is dead in your body, and this tissue is not working, that one is not working, and they have almost concluded that you cannot make it. I think you only need to meet the resurrection and the life. He calls into existence those things that be not as though they were. I am the resurrection and the life. As we pray together tonight, I don't know whether God would take these little words that doesn't look congruent. It doesn't look as if it's chronological. But I have trusted that God, who took 5 loaves of bread and 2 pieces of fish and broke it and met the needs of thousands, I trust that he will quietly come your way again. He will whisper to you and say, I'm the resurrection and the life. It's not as hopeless as you thought. I'm the resurrection. I give life where there was none. I'm able to bring back to life what was already dead. Because I'm life. And you already know when he now finally stated to Thomas, I'm the way, I'm the truth, I'm the life. As I look at who Jesus says he is, my question tonight is, could we come to him as he is? Can we come to him? Can we reach out to him afresh? Can you please drop all your struggles? The bread of life is here. The light of life is here. The door into all that God has kept in store for you is here. The door is here. But not just that, the door, the good shepherd who will take you by the hand and say, come, son, come. And it will lead you to where you have been wanting to go.
Yes, amen. Amen.
It will lead you to green pasture. It will put you where there's still waters. Yeah. I'm the door and I'm the good shepherd. And I'm the resurrection and the life.
Praise God. Praise God.
I want us to pray together tonight.
Yes, Jesus.
I want us to turn to Jesus.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
And all these things he says about himself, he wants to be that in you.
Yes.
He wants to be that for you. He wants to be that on your behalf. He wants to be that, not tomorrow, today, currently, now. For Martha, she didn't understand that. He said, I know my brother will rise in the last day, in the last day. He said, no, I'm not talking of last day. I'm saying, I'm here. I'm the resurrection and the life. What you are talking about the last day, I'm here. Do you believe this? Let's not postpone. Don't procrastinate it. Don't push it to tomorrow. And finally, do you notice that all that I've read, they are in the present continuous? Did you notice it? I am the bread of life. It didn't say, I will be the bread of life. He didn't say, I was. If he said, I was, what would that mean? Past tense is no more. He didn't use, I was. And he did not use, I will. I am. I am.
Praise God.
When he says, I am, he said it 2,000 years ago, I am. As I'm reading today, it's still, I am. Those who will read this in 10 years' time, it will still be, I am. I am. Never changes. Never reduces. What he did before, he's able to do now because he is who he has been. I am. Even in this church, I hear Jesus say, I am. I am. I'm the resurrection. I'm the life. I am. Not that I was, so don't say when he used to be. No, I am. And stop saying when he will be, when he will be. No, not what I will be. I am. I am. I am the bread of life. I am the light. You follow me now, you no longer walk in darkness. I am the door. You can enter. I'm the good shepherd. You will find pasture. And I'm the resurrection and the life. Can we relate with him who is I am? Can we relate with Jesus who says I am? And even tonight, he is. Please, let's pray together. And reach out to him. Reach out to him. Don't procrastinate when you will reach him. Reach him now. Reach him at this point. Stretch forth your hand and touch him. I am. I am the resurrection and the life. And he stands in our midst and says, I am. I'm the door. I'm the door. I'm the door. I'm the bread you have needed. I am the answer you have been looking for. Reach out to Jesus tonight. Reach out to him. He has come to our level. He has come to you. And he's saying, he whispers it. He who eats my flesh will not hunger. You will live by me. As we pray, I want you to please reach out to him as a person. This is not what someone else can do for you. Maybe it was several years ago that you first encountered the Lord. But the whole of that thing has faded out. Can you see him standing by your side again and say, I am the resurrection and the life. I am here. I can bring resurrection power into your life tonight. I can cause life to come out of your deadness. I am. I am. I am. Father, we want to reach out to you tonight. We want to reach out to you tonight, the man of Calvary. We have labored for years for meat that perishes. But even now, we see the bread that came down from heaven. We will not just admire you. We want to eat this bread. We want to swallow this again. We want your life to become our life. We want your life to flow into us afresh. Lord, please walk in this meeting tonight. Walk in this meeting tonight. I want to give you liberty, brothers and sisters, to please respond to the Lord by yourself. Have you lost sight? Do you need to regrip the man of Calvary? Do you need to lay hold of him again? Have you been diverted with the meat that perishes? Have you started knocking left and right? You left the door. And Jesus said, but I'm the door. I'm your door. Let me give room for you to please make your response to God tonight. As we are praying, you feel tonight, I want to grab the man of Calvary. I want to come to him. I want to eat this bread afresh. Don't want to grope again in darkness. I want to walk in the light of life. Don't be ashamed. He wasn't ashamed to identify with us. He wasn't ashamed to call himself one with us. He was publicly put on the cross. He despised the shame that his life might become ours. Are you here tonight and you need to say, Jesus, you are my door. And I just want to come. I want to put my hand in your hand. I want you to renew me tonight. I want you to revive my heart. I've experienced death in my spirit. But thank you that you are the resurrection and the life. I need fresh life from you. Is there somebody who don't do that tonight? Before we pray, please release yourself to God. You might want to stand up, you might want to raise your hand to God. I said, now, I want to touch you afresh. Touch me once more. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. I'll ask our brother Sam to please come. We'll stand together in prayer. And all those who desire tonight to again reconnect with the door. You want to reconnect with the man of Calvary. Just take a song as we pray.
Thank you.
And if the Spirit of God has moved you, you might want to raise your hand, you might want to stand up, you might want to just pray. See, the resurrection and the life is here. Say, if you were here, my brother would not have died. But he's here. He's here. He's here. Things that have been lost can be recovered. Things that have died can live again. The grace that was lost can be recovered tonight. The resurrection and the life is here. Thank you.